buddy.
Is this a union joke?
We're still live.
No. It's not even, okay. Hi, everybody. I'm Lorenzo Clark, and this is Vegas Nonstop with Jonathan Scott.
Thank you.
Yes. Let's hear it for him. Vegas. Yeah, Vegas Nonstop with Jonathan Scott.
Woo! Much better. Joining us, Ryan Ahern.
Ryan Ahern, owner of the Ahern Hotel right here on Sahara, across from Sahara, and Mr. Alan Bursky, who we'll get to in just a little bit.
Anyway, thanks. Thanks for tuning in, everybody.
Hi, everybody.
A few minutes late, but bear with us because it's Thursday.
Hey, let's mention Alien Tequila, our great sponsor.
George Harris.
George Harris, Alien Tequila. It's out of this world.
And by the way, it's great in coffee.
Oh, really? Yeah. We do have an amazing coffee bar here, the Aroma Coffee Bar.
Yes.
Yes, where they have amazing baked goods.
Yes, baked fresh daily here in our pastry kitchen.
Like empanadas. And
we got all that now.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Pigs in a blanket.
I was at another chocolate shop that I won't mention, but I will say that the coffee bar was the most profitable thing in the property.
It's busy.
Yeah,
it is nonstop. Great. We had to increase our hours recently.
So did you really?
We're open until 8 p.m.
Have you been to Starbucks lately?
Daily?
Yeah, they suck.
Don't tell anybody.
It used to be, it's unbelievable.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, they have...
They changed the coffee, they changed the service, you know.
You can't buy bananas anymore.
It's crazy.
They used to get a banana.
It's crazy. Welcome to Stuff Not About Starbucks. Okay.
Yeah. Alan's going to be appearing here tonight, Thursday and Friday and Saturday.
Thursday night, Friday night, Saturday night as the headliner of our A-Stars comedy show.
Yes.
And Ryan's right off the concert. It was last Sunday, wasn't it?
Yeah, last Sunday, September 1st. We had an amazing show. All of you who made it out, thank you very much for your support. And coming out, we had to add rows of chairs to the show.
It was sold out, packed out. Yeah. I'm seeing Lorenzo carrying chairs.
Telling the guys, follow me, grab a chair, let's go.
You can see all the extra chairs from my show.
That was the first concert downstairs in the main level.
Yeah, so we're very excited about the new venue. So those of you who haven't been here, we have a whole downstairs, 23,000 square foot facility. It's used for small to medium sized conventions and trade shows and things like that. But right in the middle, we built a concert stage. So now we can do a concert in the round. Usually we do about 270 degrees, but it's a huge stage. I had a 10-piece concert orchestra on that stage. We had several hundred people there for the show, and lights and sound, and it was
great.
Great.
You rocked it out.
That was amazing. Thanks. Well, yeah, my first time seeing you perform.
Yeah?
And, man, it was just like, I looked at Melissa, and I was like, Ryan's great.
Oh, thank you. Yeah.
Ryan's great.
Wouldn't it be funny if I sucked?
I'll tell you that you were great, but I wouldn't have meant it.
Okay, I appreciate it.
Because that's show business, right?
Yeah.
That's right.
I would expect nothing less.
But you know what really impressed me the most, besides your gift and your talent in playing, was your command of the stage.
Oh, we appreciate that.
Yeah, okay. He's a pro.
Yeah, I mean, you really had it. You had the audience, and you were so professional. You know, as somebody that does this, I listen to what people say, especially when they're on stage.
Yeah.
And Lorenzo's great. Lorenzo introduced you, but there was no ums. There was no
Yeah, well, you know, we're
umless.
Yes.
And it was the PBS orchestra, right? That you'd use on your PBS specials?
Yes. Yeah. So I got the two PBS specials, and this is the full group. We had the percussion section and the horn section, rhythm section. It was great.
Under the direction of our old friend Doug Tan, who we worked with for years.
Doug Tan's the best.
God.
Yeah, you know Doug Tan.
Yeah,
Dallin, you know Doug?
No, you know Doug.
Doug's great.
No, I have to ask you, give another one.
Just go shout out to Doug Tan. There you go.
It's coming up.
All right, we'll save it. Yeah,
so the next currently scheduled show is our big New Year's bash. So we have our big swinging in the New Year, and we're going to have multiple swing bands going on. On the main stage is going to be me and that same orchestra doing our big show.
Yeah, make your plans now for New Year's Eve.
Yeah, you better get tickets because it's going to sell out.
Oh, they'll be dancing.
They'll be dancing. We're going to have
2025 balloons we're going to drop.
Yep.
We're going to have a little magic show with the Magic Bros.
Yes.
Yeah.
So it's a fun night.
Rocco?
Maybe Rocco. We'll see.
Yeah. I hope we can get Rocco in.
Yeah. Is it on sale yet?
Second?
Yes, they're on Eventbrite already.
Okay.
And you can get them at a discounted price right now. Every month, the price goes up, so it might be a good time to get tickets.
And while you're there, why not think about Jocus Pocus for Halloween?
Oh, yeah.
We're doing a big, $1,000 in prizes.
Yeah, and for our costume contest.
Costume contest. and an actual A-Stars comedy show with Thing, the Adams from the Adams Family, Christopher Hart.
Yeah, Christopher Hart's coming
to be here. It's going to be amazing.
People don't realize, you know, because he's obviously the hand in the Adams Family yeah. movie series, but he's also an incredible magician. And that's probably why they even give him the role, right?
Because yeah, I think it had a lot to do with it. Yeah,
manipulation skills, and yeah. He is great.
I had a friend that used to say, "I'm a hand model. Perhaps you recognize my role."
Oh yeah.
shout out to our friend Greg Otto, who's a hand model.
Mickey O'Malley.
Oh, Mickey O'Malley, yeah.
With the Walking Through the Yellow Pages. Wow, there you go.
Oh yeah.
60 years. Oh, 60,
yeah, right. Remember the old Yellow Page ad? That was a magician named Mickey O'Malley.
That was like the woman here in town that does meow 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 meow.
Yeah, right. Yeah, yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
She's famous for that.
She's come here.
Topically, you've got the Oktoberfest coming up in September, which I've never understood.
Nobody understands it, but that is the actual.
We're a little ahead with the latest because the Hofbrauhaus, which is the official. German embassy here in Las Vegas. They're doing theirs on the 22nd, so we're going to beat them to the punch, and we're going to do the 21st. So we got an Oktoberfest here on the 21st. The big show coming up here is this Monday.
Is our
Mexican fiesta, the Independence Day, la fiesta de la Independencia.
Yes.
Fiesta with the great Paul Rodriguez. The great comedian, the original Latin king of comedy, Paul Rodriguez, is going to be here with Banda de Sinaloa. You can tell us about them.
Yeah, Banda Pura Sinaloa is a 12-piece band. It's not quite mariachi, but it's very, very close.
I saw the video today. I was looking at your video.
Yeah, they play. They're an amazing band. Just the band alone, or just Paul Rodriguez alone, would be certainly worth the price of admission. But the fact you got both of them in one show, unbelievable.
The doors are going to open at 4 o'clock?
We're going to open the doors at 4 o'clock. We're doing tequila tasting at 5 o'clock.
Yeah,
complimentary alien tequila.
Yeah, come taste.
Come have a taste of the old alien tequila.
That's the welcome cocktail?
That's the welcome cocktail. Yeah.
I'm a fan of the welcome cocktail.
Yes, exactly. And then we're going to do a drawing. There's going to be amazing nacho bar and your bar. Your bar and nacho bar.
Yeah.
But there's going to be amazing food. Chef Joel is preparing a whole plata de comidas.
Oh, yeah, I read the menu.
Plata de comidas más fina. Yeah. And we're going to have tacos. Yeah, we're going to have tacos.
Well, he said that, but it's like a long way of saying tacos.
We're going to get the early jump on Taco Tuesday and do it on a Monday. Okay, yeah. So that's Monday, September 16th. We're opening the doors at 4 o'clock. Tequila tasting starts at 5 o'clock. We're going to give drawing tickets, and every time you get a drink, you get a ticket, and we're going to do drawings for two giant piñatas that I went down to Olvera Street in Los Angeles. Got two giant piñatas.
These
that we're giving them away at the on the.
I thought we were going to smack
drawing.
Them. I was under the impression.
I checked with legal. They said we're not giving anybody a stick around the tequila. We'll see what happens. We'll see what happens.
I just like the
Lorenzo
check with legal.
Oh, no, they're full, yeah.
I like
the piñatas are full anyway you slice it. So
Lorenzo wants to be compliant. Yeah. Check with legal. Check with the boys down in R&D. Yeah. Yeah, no bats for the customers.
Yeah, but it is going to be an amazing show with the band and Paul Rodriguez.
Yeah.
Band goes on at 7, Paul goes on at 8, and then he can still hang around for another hour or so and party the night away.
On Eventbrite, but they're also welcome at the door.
Oh, yes.
Definitely.
Yes, you can get tickets at the door, and we might even... have other options like an all you can drink, all you can eat.
Yeah, I read that.
I think
40 bucks. And
yeah, I think yeah. yeah. It's really, really the great deals. Anywhere you slice it, it's a great deal.
Plus, we have our VIP front row booths.
Oh, experience. Yes, exactly. Yeah.
So if you have a party of six, it's $249. Last I checked, it gets you six tickets, and you have a front row seat, and you have a lounge like a nightclub with six leather chair seating. We don't offer bottle service or anything like that, but you do have a dedicated bar waitress that can bring you buckets of beer and anything else you want. So
perhaps some alien tequila.
I saw you had for your show, and it looked really super nice.
It was fun, right?
And that's the beauty of that booth. So it's $249. If you just want to have you and your honey, or you and your sweetie, and
put your feet on the other two. I don't
and care. Yeah, exactly. You don't have to put six people. You can buy the booth for two people.
Yeah.
So it's. Yeah. It's a great deal, and your front row, and you're VIP.
Yeah.
So check it out.
So we talked about Alan Bursky, who's sitting us right here, is going to be here this
weekend. Oh, you remember me?
Alan, in a minute. Yeah. We also have my friend Jackie the Joke Man Martley.
Martley's coming, yes.
October 10th, 11th, and 12th, and we're going to play Stump the Joke Man with Jackie.
Oh, yeah.
Which is always great. And if you were a fan of The Stern Show, Jackie was the original lead comedy writer for Howard. Yep. And if you've never seen Jackie work, he's brilliant.
Yeah.
It's how he remembers. It's almost like Lorenzo remembering all of his movie titles or TV titles. So Ryan's going to be here New Year's Eve, December 31st. Tickets are on sale for that. Any other announcements you want to make?
Yeah. I'm still here.
Yeah, we're going to get to you in just a second. We're just wrapping up here with Ryan.
Ryan's got the hotel to run, so.
Yeah, I got 500 people downstairs right now.
So that's right.
I was down there. They're having, is it like a job fair?
It's like a local business promotion. It's like a home show. More than anything,
because I know my
Chamber of Commerce
NBC
type thing.
There, and it's crowded. So, and I think it goes till 7:30. So, if you're watching right now live, you can still come on over.
Coming down the Ahern,
yeah.
Check out. I think it's like different businesses, almost like a Chamber of Commerce type. Meet and greet type of thing, and little booths, and you get to meet a lot of people, see a lot of, and they're selling a lot of cool stuff, and then stick around because at 8 o'clock it's Alan Bursky headlining on our A-Stars comedy show.
This weekend there's a gun show here,
and this weekend there's a big gun show here. That's true, and our Motown brunch on Sunday.
Yeah, we should talk
on
about
Sunday
some of those
11
shows.
A.m. But we'll talk about the rest of the stuff. Let's let Ryan get on the way.
All right,
okay. Thanks, bud.
Thanks, guys.
Always great.
Thanks,
to
Ryan.
Appreciate it.
Yep. All right,
Alan.
Hey,
see you tonight.
Can I get some extra talent?
Alan, come around, jump over here to Ryan.
Now
we're talking. Here, I'm going to move your drink for you. There you go. Look at that. Once again,
alien tequila.
Alien tequila. It's out of this world. All right.
There's an abduction in every bottle.
Well, that's what Eddie Griffin says.
So again, Paul Rodriguez, Monday. Tickets are on sale for that show. And let's get to our guest. Alan Bursky has a reputation as a comedian's comedian and a legend among his peers. You can stop me at any time while I'm doing this.
Well, I wrote that, so it doesn't really matter.
So you think that would be right.
Yeah, so.
Alan's career dates back to the 70s when he made his national television debut on The Tonight Show with Johnny Carson at the age of 18.
Right. Yes, he did.
How'd that happen at 18 years old?
Well, I originally, did magic. Grew up with David Copperfield.
I've got that.
Yeah, I can vouch for that.
He was
before he changed his name.
Yeah, the Amazing Divino, and he stole my logo. It took him 53 years to admit it. That's how I met him. So, I was doing this, magic, act, 12, 13, 14. I did what was called a manip act, manipulations with cards, this bullshit. Anyway. And people would say to me, that's how Johnny Carson started.
Yeah.
And I went, who's Johnny Carson?
The great Carsini.
Who's Johnny Carson? So I would, once in a while, like Friday night, get to stay up late, no school Saturday. And Saturday night was reruns of the Tonight Show. And I started watching the show. And in those days, the hottest comic in the world then was Flip Wilson.
Woo!
And, nobody...
And Geraldine. I'd kill it on you.
And and nobody remembers really him anymore. But he was a great comic and a great guy.
Flip Wilson.
Yeah, and I'll get to that. Later when the Comedy Store started. Wonderful man. Died way too soon, but a great comedian. And I started watching the Flip Wilson show. And the rage in those days, your comedy albums, Bill Cosby, of course. And I'll tell you a story about him. So I started collecting comedy albums, and I wanted to be a comedian, 15 years old. And just started doing it and doing it.
And where'd you grow up?
Oh, God.
In LA or New York?
16 years New York. 16 years LA. 11 and a half years New York. February will be 28 years LA.
Yeah.
But originally New York.
Yeah, Brooklyn. Brooklyn and Queens. So,
Brooklyn, Queens, and then right to Hollywood.
New York?
At that time, yeah, but I moved to L.A. and I did it in L.A.
Okay.
So, I just kept working it and working it, I always say now I'm the world's oldest young comedian. So, and I would see, young people, kids, sounds so old, starting comedy, and I talked at a class the other night. The idea is to get up, get up, get up, get up. We went around in those days. I'll give you an example. Andrew Dice Clay, who actually is the sweetest, nicest guy in the world.
Jack and Jill went up the hill, each with a buck and a quarter. Jill came down with $2.50. That
No, but I mean, he really...
You think they went up for water?
He really is. But
Andrew Goldstein, wasn't he?
Yeah, something.
Andrew Clay Silverstein.
Silverstein.
Yeah.
But Andrew would, you know, the movie, go to a movie, the Chinese theater, Grauman's Chinese theater. Before the coming attractions, he would go to the front of the crowd and go, hey, I'm a comedian. Anybody want to hear? You know,
wow.
But that's
what
it
takes. Yeah.
Get up. You know, Jerry Seinfeld.
I'm going to ask you to stop banging the table.
Oh. Yeah. It's
good. We will bury you.
Let's just hit the mic
Thank
directly.
Thank you, Mr. Khrushchev.
Yeah, who remembers that?
Nope.
So, you know, Jerry Seinfeld, a couple months ago, was speaking or said something at a class. I don't know if I have this exactly right. But basically what I heard was he said to them, if you're in a class, right, if you're here right now, you're not going to be a comedian. You should be getting up, getting
Stage
up.
Stage time.
Yeah. Before the Comedy Store opened, we moved to L.A. in February 71. I would go to all the... Sunday night was like audition night at the Ice House. Monday was the Little Club. This, you know, Marshall Edson owned it, who was also manager of Dave Madden, Susan Day, Danny Bonaducci. That Monday night was that.
The Horn?
The Horn wasn't an open mic.
Did Danny do stand-up?
We did a UCLA night at the Horn in the 80s.
But, I mean, but, you know... Where the improv is now was the old Ash Grove, like a folk place. The Troubadour had an open, you know. You got up, anywhere. Before the Viper Room opened, it used to be called Filthy McNasty's.
Yeah.
And I would go in, I don't know the guy's real name, I'd see Filthy, and I go, hey, can I get up? Can I do a set? And he would let me. But that's, you know, what it takes. When people talk to me about being a comic, I said, talk to me when you've done 1,000 shows.
Right.
So the Comedy Store opens. And there was a place called, on Lancashire near Riverside, Art Crown's Comedy Showcase. Didn't last very long. Didn't even have a liquor license. And I would hang out there and actually got a job as a bartender, Coca-Cola, coffee, you know, juice. Uh-huh. And all these guys would get up, and it went out of business. But he was the first, like, to just comedians.
Yeah, Murray Langston said that he had a club in North Hollywood.
The unknown comic, but everybody knows his name.
Yes, exactly. The unknown comic, Murray Langston.
Is Murray coming here?
Say again?
Is Murray playing here?
Murray's coming here in November, yes.
Yeah, I thought so.
Am I still talking?
Yeah. But we're always interjecting plugs for the Luxury Boutique Hotel on Sahara, across from Sahara.
Murray had the show business, comedy club he opened later.
Right.
And Deborah Winger was a waitress there.
Oh, wow.
And who remembers Deborah Winger now?
Yeah.
Anyway.
Officer and a gentleman.
So, I was with Abe Carno, you know, who was a comedy magician.
Okay.
Now a big tax expert, he's retiring. We're walking up Sunset. And in front of there's the Comedy Store, and I see these guys.
Formerly Ciro's.
I see these guys who I knew, you know, from the open mic nights. There was a wonderful comic, Harv Tretzky, and they're in front of this, you know, place. And I said, well, what's this? And they go, you know, Comedy Store, blah, 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 blah. So I try to get in. I'm 17. You had to be 21. They didn't serve food. They kept throwing me out. Rudy DeLuca and Sammy Shore. Basically, they let me go on at 5 to 2 in the morning.
Wow.
5 minutes. This is April 7th, 72. April 10th, I taped The Tonight Show, 73. I'm the first guy in the Comedy Store to get... Drove everybody crazy. My friends were, my friends were ripping my picture down. Because, you know, so I start April, 5 to 2 in the morning. By September, I'm on 9:30 at night, Saturday.
Uh-huh.
Because I worked it. Worked it. And I said this to these kids in the class. You do material. You try a joke 5 times. It doesn't work. That's it. Get rid of it. The idea isn't to extend a bit. You know, Ed Boost and I, Boost Stone and I, a wonderful comic who retired, would talk about this. You know, the idea is the most amount of laughs in the shortest amount of time. Basically,
right.
That's your style. But guys keep...
Do you remember your opener, your opening line when you were
I could be hit by a car, I'll tell you my first set. But anyway, I want to tell you this story.
What was the first joke?
Before I get into the heavy stuff I want to lay on you tonight, there's a few things I'd like to clear up, starting with my face. I really...
Did you have a shaver by Mattel?
Yeah,
I remember that line.
Yeah, that was a nice... I said, that's just a technique I use to let you people know that I'm aware that I'm kind of young to be doing this sort of thing. In fact, the thing people comment on the most after they've seen me perform aside from the total lack of humor among young people, is my age. Now I'm 18 and blah, blah, blah. That was, you know.
Yeah. That's how you got in.
Five-minute set turned into 7 minutes and 50 seconds, brought the house down. I'm back behind the curtain. In those days, it was 90 minutes, and you taped the day before. There wasn't a hookup. Oh. So I taped the 10th. It's on the 11th. I'm behind the curtain. I'm so nervous. I turned to the stage manager, who later became Jim Cantrock, and I said to him, you know what? I'm going to come back tomorrow. And if you look at the shots on YouTube or something, if you look at it, he threw me through the curtain.
He pushed you through.
Yeah, I go out like that. Now, what I didn't realize, it was the first time I did a set without a hand mic. You could actually see me look up at the boom.
Oh, yeah.
I didn't know what to do, you know, with my hands. Brought the house down. And people talk about I paddled the first shot. They're calling me over if you watch the set. I was so nervous. I'm standing there, and I'm waving bye-bye to them.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, everyone said, why don't you go over? I said, I was nervous.
Yeah.
Jerry Lewis was on the first show. Julie Budd, who was a friend I knew from New York.
Julie's a doll.
Yeah, she's great.
She's still performing.
Yeah, you should have her here.
Yeah.
Julie's great. Shout out, Julie Budd.
Shout out to Julie Budd.
No, you know, here's a girl, 13 years old, was doing the Ed Sullivan Show.
Yeah, right.
Okay, so Julie Budd, James Hampton, who was the bugle player on F Troop.
Oh, yes. Yeah, yeah.
And you know,
we haven't done F Troop yet.
Yeah, not yet.
And,
yeah.
And Johnny used to have these people on. Sam Blotner, an elderly man who lived in, I think, Costa Rica, and he was funny to talk to. That was the
show, the original show.
And the funny thing is, the night before, Johnny's announcing who's on the show tomorrow, and he mentions Alan Bursky. And he mentions someone's name. He goes, "Who's this? What the hell?" Goes, well, who's Alan Bursky? And he goes, you know what? Let's put Alan Bursky back. You know, that guy. Anyway.
So that appearance led to a guest starring role on The Partridge Family.
Yeah, they wrote me in as Dave Madden's nephew, paid me a lot of money. It pretty much was a disaster because the character wasn't real. They made this nebbishy character, but that
for
wasn't...
For your kids at home, nebbish is like a nerd.
Yeah, but that wasn't...
Why would they make him a nerd character? Why?
That wasn't my stand-up, as you know, that thing. So anyway, but you know, I was on the cover of all those teenage fan magazines and all that stuff.
He was Tiger Beat.
And 16 you did, Spec.
You did specials with Mike Douglas. People maybe don't
know
Mike Douglas.
Well, I did the Mike Douglas show. There weren't
Dinah
specials.
Shore, Dean Martin, Jim Nabors, and Richard Pryor.
Richard was a dear friend. Lunatic, but dear friend.
And then we have to talk about, and this is you wrote this, so you know it. You found yourself etched in a dark part of comedy history because of the tragic death of your best friend, and your roommate was Freddie Prinze Sr.
Yeah, and I gave up performing for 9 years, was an agent in a very large agency for a few years, and then a management company. And then, you know, I discovered cocaine and Freebase and ruined my life.
I don't know why we're laughing at that. Because
it's the revelations that you come up with. Yeah.
No, but anyway.
Yeah.
So, Richard, I'll never forget this. It was the day before Thanksgiving, so it's Wednesday night. And we're at this very well-known drug dealer's house. You'd go to her house, her apartment, and it was, you know, Lou Rawls and Belushi, and I could mention a bunch of names you wouldn't believe.
Well, you already mentioned a couple of good ones.
So they're dead.
But
so
you won't name her. Okay, you won't name her, but you'll name
the alive ones.
She's still living, and the other people are still living.
Yeah.
Anyway, so she had this little like guest house in the back of an old apartment building, like that had like 12 apartments, and you'd walk through the driveway, and because people were coming from 4 in the afternoon to 7 in the morning. After a month of this, they called the cops, and they got arrested. Anyway, I'm with Richard Pryor and some people at her house. And so the sun's not quite coming up yet.
Uh-huh.
It's Thanksgiving morning, and Richard's going to drive me back to my house in Doheny in a Rolls Royce.
So this is 4:35 in the morning.
Yeah.
It's right before sunrise.
Racing with the sun.
Yeah, yeah. You could see.
Till the sun comes up on the Santa Monica Boulevard.
Anyway, so it's you know, kind of, you know, dawn, twilight. And I'm in the car, and I said to Richard, You know, Richard, not that I'm complaining, you know, you're my idol. But no, I knew him since I was a kid because he would hang out at your little club on talent night. He met me.
Uh-huh.
And I said, you could be, and he was, at this time, he was just about to do Superman 3. He was the biggest movie star in the world at this time.
Wow.
And I said to him, you know, Richard, it's Thanksgiving today. And you could be anywhere in the world with anyone in the world. And we're in the, and it was a, now it's all gentrified, you know, Hollywood, with this part of Hollywood. And you're in this neighborhood with me.
In a Rolls Royce.
Yeah.
And you're pushing yourself.
Yeah. In a new Rolls Royce.
No, I knew Richard.
No, it's his lifestyle.
So Richard has this little vial with the spoon. He's not talking. He's, you know, sitting there. The motor's running, you know. He's giving me a couple of bumps. So I look at him, you know, and I go, Richard, why? He looks at me and goes, I got the demon.
I got the what?
The demon.
Oh.
And that's, you know, drove me home. And then the last time I saw Richard was at the Comedy Awards. There was a party at the Comedy Store. And Richard...
He was in the wheelchair at that point.
Yeah, he couldn't speak. He was like, eh.
MS.
Yeah, I know. He was glad to see me. And his wife, Jennifer... Or his ex-wife at that time was having it. He, you know, he's still in there. Yeah. Started to cry. I'm going to cry now.
Yeah.
You know.
I remember being at the store one night when they brought him up on the stage in the wheelchair.
Oh, he was.
And he was talking about the freebase accident and of course, even though he had the MS and he's in the wheelchair, still funny.
Well, yeah, but it
still
got to
funny,
the point
but it's horrible. But yeah. But when you know him, then obviously.
When he first got MS, he was at the Comedy Store main room talking. And he said he just became incontinent, you know, he's wearing a diaper and stuff. So he's talking about, you know, all the damage he did to his body, you know, when he's got MS. And it was the same time Annette Funicello announced she has MS. So Annette, I knew her first husband very well, Jack Gilardi, who was one of the heads of
my... I knew Jack.
Yeah.
That's what I see him, right?
Yeah. He just died a few years ago. And her brother, who was a very big agent at ICM, Joe Funicello, was, you know, they were my first agents, and I'm still very good friends with Joe.
I met Jack with Johnny Russo.
God, I'll tell you a story about
Carlo and the Godfather.
Yeah, Johnny Russo was playing one club in Florida, and I was playing the other. We were hanging out.
Did that club serve great tequila, like alien tequila?
I met Johnny in Florida. He was working on Any Given Sunday.
Anyway, so Annette Funicello, right? And Richard's, you know, the damn it, I got MS, and I yell out, what about Annette Funicello? And Richard goes, fucking Bursky. And he goes, maybe there's something in the Jif peanut butter. I don't know. Maybe she was smoking Jif. But, you know, also, you know, who had MS, he was a wonderful guy. David Leander, Squiggy. He died of MS. So.
Hello.
Yeah.
But hello, ladies.
But, you know, he was a wonderful...
But we need her, a couple idiots. Hello.
he was great.
Yeah.
Well, we mentioned Rodney. We always like talking about Rodney.
Yeah, totally.
And you mentioned Dice, and I know that Rodney really was instrumental in introducing Dice.
They did that special.
Young Comedian Special.
Yeah. Well, it was a Rodney special. It wasn't a Young Comedian Special. It was a Rodney special. And Bob Schimmel was on. And basically, Sam and Dice, you know, stole the show. Schimmel, if you look him up.
Robert Schimmel was brilliant.
Great comedian, wonderful guy.
He passed away too young also.
Yeah, cancer. I think he had cancer.
He had the cancer.
So, anyway.
So you were an agent for a while, then you got the bug to go back on stage. You call it your second act, working with television shows, nightclubs, theaters, stars like Drew Carey, Jerry Seinfeld, Chris Rock.
And Elaine Boozler.
Did you feel like it was like getting back on the horse or getting back on a bike?
Yeah, it was. Well, the first 2 years were tough, you know. Again, I went back to it. What am I, 30 years old at that time? You know, I was nothing special about me anymore. You know, I was the first, like, teenage stand-up comic, you know. And I had very material unique to me. Today, you know, I'm funny. I get laughs. But, you know, there's nothing... There's not that niche thing anymore.
Well, you know, Lorenzo and I have talked about it every week, and we started talking about it before the show, and you talked about comedy classes, that stand-up comedians can act, but actors can't do stand-up comedy.
And then you cited Jeremy Piven.
You mentioned
I mean, I saw him, you said you saw him out here, but I saw Jeremy at the Laugh Factory in Covina, and I got it to Covina, California, and I have to say, it's everything a comedy club should be. It was a theater that the city had, and they converted it to this club instead of, you know, Covina, wonderful area on this boulevard, completely redone, gorgeous, gorgeous club. And so I see Jeremy Piven there, and he brought the house. Piven.
And I mentioned
he brought the house down.
Had the Piven Theater Workshop. For you that are watching in Chicago, you know about
Okay, we're talking about me, not Jeremy.
But we were talking about comedians that become actors versus actors become comedians.
But there was only like really two comedians that became, you know, standout actors. It was Jackie Gleason and Richard Pryor. You know, Jerry Lewis acted or whatever.
Robin Williams.
Milton Berle. Okay, Robin Williams won an Academy Award, another one. But basically, you know, I mean, Hope was Bob Hope in all those movies. Jack Benny, you know, the problem with comedians, you know, I know people who've been producers and well-known directors to work with a comic, and they go, it was never stopped. They couldn't relate to another human being. It was all about, you know, them, you know, in acting, you know, it's like, God damn this guy, you know. So, but people like Gleason probably was one of the, you know, the best at that.
Yeah. And once again, shout out to Brad Garrett, who did a great job portraying Jackie Gleason.
Won the Emmy Award, I believe.
Yeah. And then Mike Preminger and Rick Podell wrote that script, and they're the ones who wrote that Gleason movie with Tom Hanks, Nothing in Common. And look up Mike Preminger on YouTube.
Is he related to Otto Preminger?
No. Okay. Wonderful.
But that was a great movie, Nothing in Common with Jackie Gleason and Tom Hanks.
Preminger was a great comic. He's 84 now and retired. But Preminger was of the era of, you know, David Brenner and Landisberg. But he was really original, great material. We're still good friends. I see him. Look up Mike Preminger on YouTube. Wonderful comedian.
Lorenzo had a comedy writer, Andrea Abate.
Abbott.
I was going to call her Abbott. I have a friend named Jack Abbott. And what, you know, we talked about comedy writing, writing comedy for television and sitcoms. And what Andrea had to say, and I wonder if you do this, is it's write every day.
No. I steal every day. No. There are guys like Seinfeld would write every day. Some things come to me. Sometimes I have an idea and I try and write it down. I mean, I love this joke, and I gave it to Leno for The Tonight Show years ago. I love watching biography, A&E, right?
Sure.
So one night, it's about James Dean, actor tragically killed, 26 years old. The next night, the biography was about Irving Berlin, who lived to be 101.
Sure. Yeah.
Both programs were the same length.
That's a good joke.
Yeah.
That's
so a good joke. Leno changed it for The Tonight Show to George Abbott, who was a wonderful director, lived to be 106.
Uh-huh.
But I said, everyone knows Irving Berlin. Yeah. So
about longevity.
But that kind of joke just came, you know, the next day came to me, you know.
Yeah, the program was the same way.
Yeah. The first time I ever wrote a joke, I was 16, and I was taking this correspondence course, the Hollywood School of Comedy Writing, which they were 12 booklets that were $30 a piece. This is 71. Wow. A lot of famous people took the course or whatever. These books today, if you could find them, are going to $3,000 to $4,000 a book.
Wow.
Say the name of the book again.
It's the Hollywood School of Comedy Writing, with 12 books.
School of Comedy
by
Writing.
By Ron Carver. Anyway.
By Ron Carver.
And you would write these jokes and send them in, and they would critique your stuff. The first book, it starts from writing a one-liner to the last four books on writing a sitcom. It's really the best thing I've collected all these books on comedy writing, and very rare ones for years. This is probably the best. And after that, I would recommend, Judy Carter's book, The Comedy Bible, is a terrific book. And her first book was Stand Up the Book, but Comedy Bible is a great book.
Judy Carter.
Judy Carter. Yeah.
And the two best books, she was a well-known writer in the 60s and 70s, Jean Perrette wrote a book, Comedy Writing Step by Step. It had different titles. Today, it's the new Comedy Writing Step by Step. And Comedy Writing Workbook. He wrote a bunch of books, but they're back in print. The best on comedy writing.
Okay.
And when I was a kid, it was 1971, I'm walking past the newsstand, Writer's Digest. I still have that magazine. Huh. And there's an article by Gene Perrette, How to Write Jokes. Oh, I'm like, thrilled. You never saw anything like, you know. And I met Gene and his daughter, a wonderful man. He just passed away. And he turned that article into the book, Comedy, How to Write and Sell Your Sense of Humor, a hardbound thing. That became comedy writing, and now comedy writing technique, and now it's under comedy writing step by step, or the new comedy writing step by step. But that and the comedy writing workbook, of all the stuff that's out today, and I would recommend the comedy Bible.
So if you're interested in comedy writing, Google comedy writing.
Okay, but if you're interested in doing stand-up. Yes. So anyway, the first joke I ever wrote that I realized this, and I still sometimes would do the joke. I said, you know, my parents wanted to send me to a military school, but they couldn't find one with a firing squad. And I went, wow, this is...
That's a good one.
Yeah. We mentioned the green room that Paul Provenza did, and we were talking about Jonathan Winters last week, and he was saying that, you know, when he went off to war, World War II, he came back, and his mother had cleaned out his room, and went, Mom, what'd you do with my room? He said, I didn't think you were coming back. Lorenzo mentioned that you were on the Partridge Family. I don't know how much you were on the Partridge Family.
They wrote me in. They paid me for a year of shows, and they wrote me in a whole show all about me, Al and the Family. It was the last year of the Partridge Family. It was opposite All in the Family in 74. That goes to show you. You know. Anyway, and I played Dave Madden's nephew, Alan Kincaid, who wants to be a comedian, but he's Dave Madden's assistant. Anyway, strangely enough, Dave Madden and I lived in the same apartment building in West Hollywood before I got on the show. He was, and again, here's a guy who was a wonderful stand-up comic, but he got into, you know, acting. Well, first he was on Laughing, but he was on Camp Run Amok, a sitcom. Who the hell's calling it?
Keep talking.
You know, but it's Paul Rodriguez. Oh. I have the W-9, and I'm ready to turn it in.
Okay, great.
Paul Rodriguez will be here on Monday.
Paul Rodriguez will be coming. This will be Monday, September 16th, for our Mexican Independence Day Fiesta.
What do I tell him to turn it into?
Just tell him. Text
email it to
me.
Lorenzo.
Email, yeah.
Email. That's LorenzoClark.com. So we play a game here on
Vegas.
What's
Lorenzo?
Lorenzo.
Lorenzo.
All right, there you go. Perfect.
Called Truth or Brown Sugar.
Right.
And Truth Lorenzo or BS. Suggested that we play it with the Partridge Family.
Right. We do this. God. We do this with every sitcom. So now we're doing it with the Partridge Family.
With the Partridge Family.
In honor of you,
because you were on
being here, and your relationship with Susan Day and Danny Bonaducci.
Well, I was friendly with Danny Bonaducci before the Partridge Family. Met him at the Magic Castle.
Oh yeah.
And knew his father and mother, and then I get on the show. And I'll tell you something, Danny was teasing the crap out of me. And I'm only 5'5". Danny must have been 5 feet in those, 4'11". A little chubby. And I go, damn it, Danny, I'm gonna brain you. I go to grab him. He jumps in the air and does a spinning crescent kick, hits me right in the mouth, and breaks my lip. And, you know, Danny, if you look at him being a little, you know, little guy and a little chubby kind of...
But apparently he went to the Chuck Norris school.
Well, that's what he was studying with. I went, where the hell did you learn to do that? And you know what's funny? Years ago, this was, the early 90s, Danny challenged Donny Osmond.
I was there. I was in the front row. That's my story with Danny. One of my stories.
Well, here's the thing.
Donny really won.
I didn't see it, but I said...
What kind of a fight was it?
Boxing.
Yeah, but
okay.
I said that was it.
He didn't get to do a spinning heel kick. That's his signature move.
I said to Donnie, you know, the problem with this, you don't realize this, you're a wonderful guy. Danny's going in that ring to kill you.
Yeah.
Danny
was serious.
Yeah. Danny is, you know, is going there to hurt you. You're going in there, you know, to box or whatever. Danny, you know, you're getting in the ring with the wrong person, trust me. And Danny, by then, lost a lot of weight. He was in shape. I said, yeah, I wouldn't do this if I were you.
Well, Donnie didn't know what hit him, quite honestly. And Danny was really going for it. Shout out to, again, all my friends in Chicago, Larry Wirt, Mark Wilhelms. They put that match on. Mark Wilhelms, Willie had the idea to do it. And it was a charity event, and it was a full house. It was at the China Club in Chicago. And
this is Danny Bonaducci versus Donny Osmond.
It was,
what year?
In, I don't know.
In the last century.
It was 93. And my friend Larry Wirt actually signed Danny Bonaducci to be on the radio.
Right.
He was on the Loop radio station, WLUP.
I did that show with him.
In Chicago. And he so appreciated my friend Larry Wirt that he had his name tattooed on his ass. He said, I love Mr. Wirt.
And he married
a Wirt
Isabella on his first date.
He married Gretchen, I think her name was. She was a waitress at one of the comedy clubs in Chicago.
Yeah, in the first date, they got married on the date.
Ain't that something?
Yeah, well...
Didn't work out that way. He was happy for a little while.
That's a reality show.
It was really great on the radio.
I heard that, yeah.
Dig that!
I was living on Hollywood Boulevard, right near La Brea. Not the big fancy high-rise building, but another nice building. 4 in the morning, there was just screaming going on. And I mean, like, you thought someone was being killed, yelling. I called the cops. He goes, yeah, we've had a lot of complaints. It was coming from these condos they just built. Right across the street from me. Anyway, one day I'm pulling my car out and I see Danny coming out of the building. Danny lived there, and that's who was fighting. I went, oh, now it makes sense, whatever.
The first night I met Danny was at the Ultimate Sports Bar and Grill in Chicago, and I heard screaming in the back room. I go
There's
in the back
continuing
room.
Theme
it
here.
It was a Sam Adams beer promotion. And Danny whipped it out for the
oh wow,
the just, and she was hello. Screaming, and that's how I met Danny.
Wow,
we became
all right.
friends after that. He's just a great, sweet guy. You know, if you got to know him, he was.
Yeah, just look. Believe me, I know about getting caught up.
Child star. I mean,
and demons. You know, so.
Yeah,
you know.
He had his, and God bless him. I hope he's okay. You know,
he was doing very well. He actually was. On the radio in a few places.
Minneapolis, I think
Philadelphia, I'm not sure. Anyway, when I did the show in Chicago, I always laugh about this. His producer or sidekick was the only other person I ever met with the name Shemp.
Besides the Three Stooges.
Yeah, right. The guy's name was Shemp, and I went, it's really your name? He goes, Shemp.
People on radio always have radio.
No, but that was his name.
Yeah.
It was his real name.
Okay. Yeah, Shemp.
He was great on the radio. He had a great run in Chicago on the radio. Anyway, I don't know if we're going to have time to do this.
I think we can do it quick. Let's do it. This is called Truth or BS.
Truth or Brown Sugar. Richard Pryor and Lou Gossett Jr. guest starred as brothers having a benefit performance to save their firehouse. What group was scheduled to play, but because of a scheduling mix-up, the Partridge Family was sent instead?
Chad and Jeremy.
The Temptations, the Jackson 5, the Miracles, or the Four Tops?
Jackson 5.
Miracles.
Temptations.
The Temptations. Right.
Keith was asked to chaperone a beautiful princess in one episode. Which actress played the role?
Cheryl Ladd.
Karen Valentine, Farrah Fawcett, Susan Holly.
Oh, Farrah Fawcett.
Or Sean Barbara Allen.
Oh, wait a minute. I know
Karen Valentine.
Yeah, I know Farrah Fawcett was on the show. Who's the other one you named?
I don't know, but it was Susan Hubley.
Cheryl Ladd was on the show.
I don't know who they are, but it was Susan Hubley.
Cheryl Ladd was on the show. You know, Rob Reiner was on the show. Richard Pryor was. There were a lot of, you know,
amazing.
Big names who did guest stars.
It was a huge show. In one episode, Lori got braces. However, they kept picking up radio signals. At one rehearsal, a rock group's music was playing in her mouth. Which group was it?
Chad and Jeremy.
The Hollies, the Carpenters, the Rolling Stones, or the Beatles?
The Beatles.
No, it would have been someone cheaper. They
it had to be the Hollies.
Right, they got
to
pay the Hollies.
Rolling Stones.
The Stones, baby.
The family pet was a dog named Samantha. Truth or Brown Sugar?
Brown Sugar. Brown Sugar.
I don't know.
We're almost
brown
done.
Brown Sugar. No, the dog's did. Name was
Tell
Simone.
We're almost done.
Okay.
In one episode, the Partridge Family was scheduled to perform for children in a hospital. What song did they perform? I Can Feel Your Heartbeat, I Think I Love You, Brand New Me, or Together Having a Ball?
It wasn't I Think I Love You.
Together Having a Ball.
I Can Feel Your Heartbeat.
Brand New Me. One episode featured the family. I'm flying through this. One episode featured the family performing a song about a man trying to reach his long-lost love by telephone after a considerable period of time. Name the telephone number he tried to call.
867-5309.
That's what I thought it was.
No, that was before that.
I saw it.
Pennsylvania, 65,000. Right in the middle,
Beachwood, 4578-9770-9311 or Echo Valley, 28680.
Echo Valley.
Echo Valley.
Echo Valley. In one episode, a young runaway named Maggie hitched a ride with the family. Where was her intended destination? Phoenix, Arizona, Mesa, Arizona, Roswell, New Mexico, or Albuquerque?
Albuquerque.
It was Albuquerque.
Albuquerque.
There was a song.
Do you know the way to Albuquerque?
Family. Song.
In one episode, Chris ran away because he thought he was adopted. Truth or Brown Sugar?
Truth.
Truth.
Truth. The group intended Shirley to be a vocalist in the group. Truth or Brown Sugar?
Truth.
True.
BS.
OBS?
Yeah, not original.
Oh, really? She was the only one other than David who sang on the records.
Yeah. I got the record thing.
And we knew she could sing.
Better answer than that.
She could wash that man right out of her hair.
The group had planned to audition another vocalist. When she didn't show up, they decided to ask Mom to join them.
Oh, yeah, that was the plot line.
Yeah. The Partridge Family was loosely
Danny based. Got Ruben to sell our song, and it sure came together when Mom sang along. Come on, world, there's a song.
All right, Larry.
Come on, get happy.
The Partridge Family was loosely based on the real-life family group, the DeFranco family.
Cowsills.
The Cowsills. All right.
And that's how we play Truth or Brown Sugar.
Truth or Brown Sugar, yes. That's
the Reader's Digest best version of Truth or Brown Sugar. Because you've got Bo Rodriguez texting you on your phone.
Go Speed Racer, go. It's BS.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, I get it. Okay.
So yeah, I know you
so
get it
now. So we don't say bullshit.
Yeah, we don't want to say. Don't want to say bullshit.
Alan Burstyn.
We're talking about Alien Tequila.
Saturday here at Ace.
Thursday night, Friday night, Saturday night. Three big nights.
Thank you to George Harris. Alien Tequila, an abduction in every bottle. Thank you, Lorenzo.
It's out of this world.
Thank you to Ryan Ahern.
Yes.
Thank you, everybody.
And everybody in the Ahern Hotel, the Ahern Luxury Boutique Hotel on Sahara across from the Sahara.
Final.
I just want to say this. You know, when you're talking about Ryan playing the piano and being a great showman and performer, you know, when I was an agent at APA, they said, I was in Vegas, you got to go see Liberace. And I wouldn't go. And they said, if you don't go today, you're fired. I go to the Hilton, see Liberace. I learned more about stage presence and showmanship watching Liberace than I ever did from a comedian. It was unbelievable.
Liberace.
So when you talk about Ryan being this showman, it's amazing. You know,
he's the next Liberace.
Yeah, no, but I hope not.
Well, I say this all the time.
As far as the piano's concerned,
that it's about engaging your audience, and that was something that Ryan was great at, and was something Liberace. I got to see Liberace.
I wish my brother George were here.
I got to see Lee, and shout out to Susan Jane Liberace, who watches the show.
Yes.
She's a fan of the
show. Lee had this joke, oh, look at your diamonds. Wow, those are a woman in the audience.
I didn't have to do what you had to do.
No, because I didn't do anything for mine.
Yeah.
You know, talk about when he died, you know, people said what a wonderful person he was. He lived in Palm Springs. Sunday morning, he called the police to tell the church to stop ringing the bell.
I'm Jonathan Scott. If you've got any comments, just drop me an email at news1lasvegas@gmail.com. That's news1lasvegas@gmail.com. Thank you, everybody. Thanks for watching.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you for sure.
Thanks, everybody.
Show me a picture of your daughter.
Nice to see you.
She's a little old for me.
Take care now.
I'm going to shut the camera up.
Yeah, let's
stop.
Let's wave goodbye. Wave goodbye.